When you grow up, you tend to get told that the world is the way it is, and your life is just to live your life inside the world, try not to bash into the walls too much, try to have a nice family life, have fun, save a little money. But life, that's a very limited life. Life can be much broader. You can change it, you can mold it. Once you learn that, you'll never be the same again.
Pastor Aaron, and I'm really excited because I get to continue the Wonder Life series. I get the unenviable task of following Pastor Charity, who has been absolutely amazing the last couple weeks. And I'm not just saying that because I am not trying to earn brownie points for later. I am just being honest that she's done fantastic. Pastor Danny wanted me to tell you hello to all of you that remember Pastor Danny. He's currently enjoying his feet of snow in Maine. He was sending us pictures the other day of look at my backyard, and I went, ha, 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 giggled. They had snow like this tall. It was crazy. But we're going to continue talking about Wonder Life. Week one, we talked about the Wonder Life begins when we stop trying to earn God's love and we start trying to learn his love. We already have it. Now we just want to learn more of it. And last week, we learned that God wants to turn your dead ends into detours to prepare you for your destiny. That when you pull up in a foreign country to the front door of a church that's letting out in an alleyway because you got lost in Spain, that God will give you a way out of that. If you didn't see that and you're like, what are we talking about? Go to graceplacetacoma.org. That's our website, Grace Place. We live in Tacoma, so it's graceplacetacoma.org. You can remember it really easily. And there's a new link I just put up a couple weeks ago for media, and you get to, it'll take you to our YouTube page, and you'll get to see all the messages. And you'll get to see Wonder Life's week one, week two. And it's really important if you missed out that you go back and watch those and you take really good notes, because in a couple weeks when we finish, we're going to give you a test. And I want you to know that if you do well on that test, the result is we're going to pick parking spots based on your test results. And so if you want a good parking spot, you got to do well on your test. We'll do that every spring and summer and quarter. I'm just kidding. Just kidding. We don't do that if you're first time. That's not what we do. If you want a good seat and a good parking spot, you just have to show up early. But it's important that you get caught up. And we're going to talk this week, but I'm going to start with a story. Don't do that screen. Stay there. I was showing my kids a picture this week, and Savannah's like, who's that? That's me. Well, what do you mean? I was like, that's when I was like 19. She's like, but what's that on your head? I was like, it's my hair. And my 20th high school reunion is in June, and so I've been getting a lot of Facebook posts. I've been showing the kids, and so we've been reliving my glory days. And if we're reliving my glory days, we're going to talk about my amazing football career when I was younger. Now, I always played football as a young kid, and I was always the quarterback on the team, always the quarterback. I was taller and skinnier and better than everyone else. But by ninth grade, my body stopped recognizing I was an athlete. And no longer was I taller than everyone, and I was hefty now. I wasn't skinny, I was hefty. If you don't know what hefty means, it's just a fancy word for a tub of goo. That was me. And so I was the backup quarterback, and the other quarterback, he could run really well. Chris was a really good athlete. I wasn't. And so Chris started, but I got to play a lot because Chris got hurt like every single game. So Chris would run out, he'd get smashed, I'd come into the game, and there's this one particular game. We're playing Lake Ridge. Now, this is ninth grade, which is junior high for us. I know high school out here, but we did it right in Puyallup. And we played Lake Ridge, and they were out in Bonnie Lake, and we're down 6-0, and again, Chris gets hurt. Aaron's coming in, time to save the day. We call a deep pass to the right. Aaron says to the huddle, I got this, boys. We're going to win this game. So Aaron gets on the other side. I snap the ball. I go back, and it's just a beautiful step back, 5 steps. I see my receiver, and I throw it as far as I can throw it, perfect spiral. It was beautiful, and John catches it in stride, and he walks into the end zone. We kick the extra point. I am the hero of the school. Yeah, I'm in the newspaper. Aaron threw the winning touchdown pass. The only problem with that story is that's actually not how it happens. So I get into the game. I take a snap back. I don't think I took 3 steps, let alone the 5-step drop. And that's important because my line's really tall and I can't see over. So I just go, and I throw it as far as I can to the right. And from what I was told, because I couldn't see it, the cornerback, the defender, tipped the ball. But then Don was able to catch it, and he ran in and scored. Again, that's what I've heard. I've never seen it because I didn't see it then. But that was the story of me and my greatest moment. 2 weeks later, we're playing Ferrucci, and I go in to save the day again, and it did not go well. It went pretty awful. I look ridiculous running around trying to run for my life. But I had that moment, and I loved football. And while I wasn't going to play quarterback anymore, I loved playing other positions, and so I was training that summer to get ready for high school. But in eighth grade, go back a little bit, I got hurt, and I screwed up my ankle. I had bone spurs, I had bones that fused together, so I had major ankle surgery as in eighth grade. And the doctors told me, do the physical therapy and then exercise. It's going to hurt like the dickens for a long time. But the more you work it out, the better it's going to be. So I would run, and about 2 blocks in, oh, my ankle hurts. And it would start to become an excuse not to run. Now, I don't even know if my ankle hurt or it was just my brain kind of wimping out on me and saying, let's not run. And so that summer, I was so scared that I heard these horror stories of the coach. He would make you run till you threw up, because this was just before the rules and everybody changed, when water was still like the enemy. And he would make you run and run and throw up. And I was like, that doesn't sound like fun. I can't run. I'm hurt. Physically, I'm unable to do it anymore. And I didn't play football. I gave up. And 23 years later, it's still one of my life's biggest regrets, because after my sophomore year, we got this new coach, and he was a breeze to work with. It was a lot of fun, but it was too late. I was done. What happened to me is I let something that happened to me get inside me, and I gave up on my dreams. I gave up on my life. And I think it's something that's important to us, and it illustrates, you know, our life. That things are going good, things are going well, and then something happens to us, and we go through a bad season, a bad moment. Bad things happen to us, and we don't fight the fight. We give up. We walk away. It's bad things happen to us, and then we let it happen in us as well. And this morning, we're going to say there is a difference between what happens to you and what happens in you. Because in life, we're going, okay, life's good, and then we get a new boss, and it's all upside down. We get a new neighbor, and then our whole world's a mess. And you know, maybe you got kids this morning, and you're here going, it's Sunday, and another week's about to start. I am so worn out. I am so tired. Life was pretty balanced, and now it's all upside down. It's frustrating. Parents, if you've had a newborn, you understand that you've never been more exhausted than that first year of their birth. It's the most exhausting thing. I don't know what that's like. I waited until my kids were grown up, and then I married Charity. She already had 2 kids, were 7 and 12. I didn't have to change diapers. I didn't have to wake up. So, but as newborn parents, you know that it's exhausting. Some of you have kids are in their 20s, 30s, and 40s. And they're more exhausting now than they were when they were babies. They have mentally, physically, and spiritually worn you out. And you're like, you know what? I'm just ready to kind of give in to life. I'm just ready to quit. All of these conditions have just made you say, I'm going to not die, but I'm just going to go with the flow. Life gives us reasons to quit, but today I want to give you reasons not to quit. I want to give you the option to rise up. When you want to quit, there's another way. There is that you rise up. And it starts with our first thought that's in your worship guide. You can take those out. We give you notes so you can follow along and study during the week. And it all starts with this first truth, that what happens in you is more important than what happens to you. Now, first off, everyone's like, whoa, wait a minute. That's not what I think. The world tells you the opposite. That tells you what happens to you is more important than what's in you. But I'm here to tell you this morning, what happens in you, is more important than what happens to you. The work that God is doing on the inside of us, how he is teaching us, the work he is doing in our hearts, is more important than the things that have happened to us. Now, we can't often control those things that happen to us, but we can control the way we respond to them. So let's look at the story of Joseph. It's the theme story of this series. We've been looking at Joseph. Last week we ended with he got sold into slavery. But let's back up a little bit. Joseph is the youngest son of multiple brothers, and he is the favorite son of his father. And his dad shows it in many ways. And his brothers hate him for it because they know dad loves him more than them. And then Joseph has dreams that they believe the dreams at the time, it was God visions. And Joseph's getting these dreams that one day his brothers, that are saying his brothers are going to bow down to him. And he goes and tells his brothers because that seems smart. And his brothers were angry about it. I think we all would be in that boat. Except for then his brothers decide, let's just kill him. Let's get rid of him. So they plot and they decide to throw him in a cistern, and which they do, which is a big pear-shaped hole where water would collect. And there's no water at this moment. They throw him in there. But then they have a moment of mercy, if that's what you want to call it. And they go, hey, you see those Ishmaelite traders? Why kill them when we can make money off of them? So they decide, let's sell my brother because that's better. And they decide to sell Joseph into slavery. Can you feel the love tonight? Can you feel the familia wrapped up when you thought your family was a mess? So let's catch up with the story in Genesis chapter 39, verses 1 through 3. Says, when Joseph was taken to Egypt by the Ishmaelite traders, he was purchased by Potiphar, an Egyptian officer. Potiphar was the captain of the guard for Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. And verse 2 says, the Lord was with Joseph. Think about that sentence. They tried to kill me. They sold me into slavery. Now I'm in Egypt. I'm far away, and it says, the Lord is with me. That doesn't match up with maybe sometimes how we think. Sometimes we look at our circumstances and we decide, okay, God's with me today. Life's going bad. God's not with me today. But this story says, at his worst moment, that the Lord was still with Joseph. Maybe for you, your life is tough at this moment. Maybe your life is really, really hard. Maybe it's crazy, lunatic, outstandingly crazy, upside down at this moment. You're like, Aaron, if you only knew how crazy my life was right now, it would take multiple days and every tissue that Costco has to get us through the issues that I have right now. But I want you to know that no matter where your life is, remember, the Lord is with you. As some people like to say, just saying. So back to the story. The Lord is with Joseph, and so he succeeded in everything he did as he served in the home of his Egyptian master. Potiphar noticed this and realized that the Lord was with Joseph, giving him success in everything he did. You got to imagine for Joseph that there is moments when he kept thinking, can my life get any worse? I'm in the bottom of a pit. I'm a slave. Can it get any worse? I'm in Egypt. Can it get any worse? He had to have the thought of, why am I trying? Why don't I just give up and give in to life? He could have had this conversation in his head. I had it all. I was father's favorite son. My brothers were going to bow down before me one day. And now I'm at the bottom of life. I'm a slave in a far-off land. My family betrayed me. But the story shows that Joseph never does that. He doesn't quit. He learned to rise up, not give up. He learned this by putting some principles into his life, and we're going to look at those today and say when we're going through these moments, if something happened to us, we recognize it's not what happens to us, it's what happens in us. And the first principle we have to learn from this story is don't play the blame game. Don't play the blame game. Now, we love to blame people for our lives. In fact, there's a growing trend of people doing ridiculous lawsuits to blame people for everything that happened to them. I got examples. A man sued Budweiser for $10,000 recently for emotional distress because he drank Budweiser and he did not become more attractive to the opposite sex. The commercial said women would show up. He drank, it didn't work out, and he sued for $10,000. Kind of ridiculously to blame that on that. There's a guy who sued, the NFL and the $88 billion because for emotional distress and corruption because a few years ago, Dez Bryant caught a touchdown pass against Green Bay that was ruled not a catch, and it cost Dallas the game. And so he decided that I'm going to take it out, I'm going to blame the refs, and I'm going to sue them. But we've all heard the stories of ridiculous lawsuits. It's because we're all looking to blame someone else. Now, we have to look at Joseph because he actually had the right to blame someone. He could blame his brothers, and he would have been right to. But he never did. He didn't blame anyone. People, we blame all kinds of things for our life. We're all really good at it. I'm pretty good at it. There's times if I'm in a bad mood, it's her fault. It's my kid's fault. If the Seahawks aren't doing well, what do we all say? Stupid refs. Now, honestly, it's only really been true one time, and that was the 2005 Super Bowl. The referees screwed up and stole the Super Bowl for us. On the other times, they're just making honest mistakes. But now work's going bad. It's my boss's fault. It's Sheila in the corner's fault. It's those stupid customers. It's my coworkers. Home's going bad. It's my kids. It's my spouse. It's that dumb dog. It's their fault the way things are going out. If my finances are bad, who do we blame? We blame the government, right? We blame taxes. We blame the system. We blame people who have more stuff than us. We blame everyone. And here's the thing you need to know. You cannot blame your way to a better life. You don't blame your way to a better life. That's your next point. Blame does nothing for you. You can believe your way to a better life. You can work your way. You can pray your way. But you cannot blame your way to a better life. See, blame's a lot like burping. When you have to burp, come on, we're all humans. We all do it. Builds up some pressure, right? You got to get a release, right? And then you burp, and it goes out, and then you're like, oh, I feel so much better. The problem is there's probably people standing around you that are completely grossed out about what you did. It smells, and now they're like, I'm done with that guy, and they leave your life. Blame does the same thing. It builds up in us. We let it out. Oh, we feel better, but it pollutes the air around us and all the people around us. It doesn't fix anything. Joseph could have blamed. He had real cause. He had legal and righteous justification to blame someone, but he never did. He never sought, it's my brother's fault. They betrayed me. I didn't do anything wrong. God, why am I paying for their sin when they're getting away from it? He doesn't say that. And he could have said, God, I'm quitting. I'm giving up because they did this to me. I'm not going to try anything anymore. I'm not going to trust anymore. I'm not going to be around anyone anymore. I'm angry. God, this is why I lose my temper. God, this is why I'm short with people. God, this is why I give up. This is why I'm not trying. This is why I don't apply myself. Any of this start to sound a little familiar? But he doesn't do that. Blame, blame, blame. He could have lived there, but he didn't. You will never, when you blame, you will never rise. You will be stuck. Because you're shifting the responsibility for your life onto someone else or onto something else that happened to you. When you blame, it paralyzes you. And it keeps you from owning it and finding healing. When you blame, it keeps you from finding solutions and finding an answer and moving forward in your life. It accomplishes nothing. A lot of people say, well, I just need justice. Give me justice and I will have peace. And I've watched people my whole life get justice for the crimes committed against them. And I've watched more than not that it doesn't change anything about them. They're still bitter. They're still angry. They're still the victim. They still blame the person. They don't allow God to begin to heal and work in them and through them. We need to allow God to move because what happens in you is more important than what happens to you. So you have to let God do the work in your life. We have to recognize what happened, yes. We have to own what part of it we can own and be responsible for the one thing we can control, and that is how we react. Then we can move forward, not as a victim, but as a victor. Someone in here this morning needs to hear this. You do not have to live as a victim. You may have been victimized, but you are not a victim. You do not have to live like one. Society is full of people right now who want to tell you who you are. That something happened to you, and you're nothing more than that incident. You were victimized, and now that is who you are. You are a victim. Your life is not better because someone did something to you. Your life's not better because someone said something to you. Someone created something. You were born into the wrong family. So you're a victim. You were born in the wrong race. You were born poor. You were born rich. You were born of the wrong race. You were born of the wrong gender. You were born of the wrong religion. Your kids have a health disease. So you're a victim, and you need all these people to come around and say and validate you as a victim. The society is telling you that. The world's telling you that. This country right now is in an identity crisis within individuals. Your news media is telling you're a victim. Your precious politicians, you're a victim. Sadly, civic leaders and preachers are telling everyone, you're a victim, you can't move beyond that. But I'm telling you this morning, you're not. Why? Because God says you're not a victim. He says you are a victor. You have victory, not gonna get it. You have it right now. It's already been paid for, and you need to live in it and stop being a victim. I'm a little animated because I'm tired of the world getting to tell you who you are, because that's not who God says you are. You have to stop believing that you have figured out the one situation, you have got the one crime, you have got the one thing happened to you that God can't conquer. Because that's where we go. I hear you, Aaron, I got you, but you don't know my past. But God does, and he's bigger than it. Well, God, you don't know what that man did to me. God knows, and he's bigger than that. That's why we sing the song. What a beautiful name it is. It's the name above all names. It's the name against abuse. It's the name against rape, against betrayal, against deceit, against hate. It's above all of that. You have to find your victory this morning. Joseph didn't let what happened to him keep him from the living life and moving forward. You have to recognize that right now there is a battle for your identity in this present age, like there has never been before in the history of man. You've all heard of identity politics, right? This is nothing more than the devil trying to confuse people who God made them to be, who God called them to be. If I can convince you you're not male, you're not woman, you're nothing, I can convince you that God isn't real and God doesn't exist. That's the idea. That's what's happening right now. And that's why liberals and conservatives and everyone wants to grasp onto a title. But you're not that. You're what God says you are, and you have to recognize that the devil wants you to fall for the trap of identifying yourself with what happened to you. But this morning, I want to remind you that in Christ, you are a victor. You are not the sum total of your circumstances. In Christ, you are an overcomer. In Christ, you're not just your pain, your past, your mistakes, and your failures. You are in Christ. You are forgiven. You are redeemed. You are free. In Christ, it's not just what was done to you. You are ultimately what God can do through you. In Christ, you're just not the sum total of all of life and what everyone else has said about you and what they are labeling you right now. You are who God says you are. In Christ, you have a future. In Christ, you can move forward. In Christ, you can live different. Now, what happened to you might be horrible, unspeakable, because we know in Joseph's time it was. But that's different than what's happening in you and can happen in you. And you've got to fight the battle. You've got to work through those things with God so that you allow him to move through your heart and your life. Because what happens in you is more important than what happens to you. Now, here's the next principle that we need to recognize this morning if we're going to rise up. And I think it's the one we underestimate the most. And it is the build up to breakthrough. Everyone wants breakthrough without the buildup. But it's build up to breakthrough. America loves a good underdog story. The NCAA tournament's in a couple weeks, and we're all going to pick the 15 and 14 seeds. We're all going to root for the underdog to beat the big, bad, big colleges. All except the Washington, because we're not going to get even close. We love stories of people accomplishing great things, overcoming odds. But we see their accomplishment, and we don't recognize all the work and misery they went into it sometimes. Now, I have a great story that kind of illustrates this. In 1809, there was a boy born into an extremely poor family who lived in a one-room house. At 7 years old, the family was evicted, and that seven-year-old had to go to work to support them. In 1818, his mother died. In 1831, he failed in business. In 1832, he ran for the state legislature. He lost. He also lost his job that year, and he wasn't able to go to law school. In 1833, he borrowed money to start a business. By the end of the year, he was bankrupt, and it took him 17 years to pay off that money. In 1835, it just gets better, his sweetheart, who he's engaged to marry, dies. In 1836, he has a complete total nervous breakdown and lays in bed for 6 months. And I think for most of us, this is when we tap out. That's enough. I can't take any more. I'm done. I'm giving up. 1843, he got back up and he ran for Congress. And he lost. 1849, he ran for land officer in his home state, and he lost. 1854, he runs for the Senate, and he lost. 1856, he goes to this party's convention to be their vice presidential candidate, and he gets less than 100 votes, and he lost. 1858, he goes back to run for the Senate, and he loses again. 1860, Abraham Lincoln was elected President of the United States of America. His birthday was last week. Tomorrow we recognize presidents. His buildup was brutal. I wouldn't wish that on my enemy. But man, what a breakthrough through all of that buildup because he didn't quit. We know the end result of what he did, but we forget what got him there. It prepared, all that stuff prepared him to lead our nation through civil war, which was the most defining moment in our nation's history. But all of that was pointed to prepare him. And he left his family and he left his friends and he left his home to go to Washington, D.C. And he left with these words. He says, I now leave not knowing when or whether ever I may return. With a task before me greater than which rested upon Washington. Without the assistance of the divine being, whoever attended him, I cannot succeed. With that assistance, I cannot fail. I have to go and do this great thing, but without God, I'm going to fail. He gives you a clue to how he got through the buildup. That God got him through all of that, and the God who let him go through all of that was still his God to help him achieve all the things he did. Joseph's story shows some of the same things. In chapter 39, verse 5, it says, from that day, Joseph was put in charge of his master's household and his property. The Lord began to bless Potiphar's house for Joseph's sake. Side note, you ever thought about how God can bless your job that you don't like and talk bad about for your sake? The Potiphar wasn't getting blessed for his sake, but he was getting blessed for Joseph's sake. And all his household's affairs ran smoothly, and his crops and his livestock flourished. Joseph was in charge of everything, and he had to overcome hate, blame, anger, and there's no indication that he ever stopped and focused on these things. But there is this. He focused on what was right in front of him so he could build up his situation right where he was. He could have resented and blamed. He could have blamed God for making him a slave, but you just don't see that. You see him building on what's right in front of him, doing what's right there, and going through his buildup, knowing someday breakthrough is going to happen. Some of you are waiting for your destiny. Some of you are waiting for your breakthrough. You're begging God, I need breakthrough this morning. I need breakthrough in my life. You need breakthrough in life, in your jobs. Maybe it's your family. Maybe it's your marriage that you need breakthrough. Here's the tough reality of breakthrough. Until God builds you up, you're not ready for your breakthrough. And that sucks. Because we have to recognize that the breakthrough might actually break us if God isn't built us to what we're ready to be. So until you get to that place and ready for breakthrough, let God build you up, let him work in you, let him shape you, let him form you, let him make you ready for the breakthrough. Build-up's hard. We feel like sometimes we can never get ahead. Joseph's goal was never in life to be a good slave. That wasn't the end goal, but it was what was right in front of him. And he had to go through all the things he could go through so God can get him in the place and the position so he could be ready for breakthrough. In my life, there are some things that I have been ready for breakthrough for almost 2 years now. And I have thought multiple times that, here we come, God, I'm ready, let's do this. And God's gone, nope, a little bit more, a little bit more. And it hurts. It's hard. This buildup process can feel overwhelming. But Joseph reminds us that half the battle of the buildup is not quitting. That's half the battle is not to quit. What if Abraham Lincoln had quit along the way? Where would our nation be? I thought months ago that I was ready for a breakthrough in some things, and you know what? If it had happened, I can recognize now, it had ruined me. It had ruined my life. It'll ruin this church if it was out of timing. But what has happened as I've gone through all of this buildup is the buildup has built my relationship with God. It had to because it was the only thing I had to keep me to survive through the buildup. My prayer life today is light years ahead of where it was a year ago. My reliance on God has never been stronger. And I've learned so much along the way that the hard times have forced me to change and to grow and to be different. And along this build-up process, I've become a new me. And I've learned that's the whole point, that God's been building me up to something new. And I'm not sure I'm there yet. I'm not sure when my breakthrough will come. But I know two things. One, it is coming. And two, I'm not quitting until it does. I've gone through too much to stop now. And I need you to get that today. I need you to not quit. Don't quit because it's hard. Don't quit because you can't see a way out. Don't quit. I have watched people over the last few years in either recovery situations or spiritual matters in here go through tough times, and we have fed into them, and you can see it before they see it. They're about to quit. And we have watched them walk away in either recovery or in their life, and they've walked away from marriages, and they've walked away from relationships, and they were this close to breakthrough, and they'll never know it. Because they quit at the finish line. And some of you right now are at that point. You're ready to lay down and just let life happen. Some of you, we've talked to you. Some of you, I've said that, and you know exactly right now who you are in this room. Don't quit. Don't give up. Don't lay down. Hang in there. Don't quit when family and friends betray you. Don't quit when someone hates on you. Remind yourself of the old hymn. Haters are going to hate, hate, hate. And baby, I am just going to shake, shake, shake it off. About half of you got that. That was awesome. Don't quit because you have to recognize you are deeply loved. You are highly favored. Don't quit when people say things bad about you, when they kick you when you're down, because it doesn't matter what people say you are. In the final analysis, it matters what God says. He says you are loved. He says you are empowered. He says you are embraced. You are one of his children. You are God's beloved. You are made in his image. He shaped you. He formed you. So don't quit just because it's hard. Don't give up because you want to quit. Don't give up because others are doing better than you. Don't give up because others are getting promoted and you're not. Don't give up because other people are getting blessed and you're not. Don't give up because your situation seems overwhelming. Don't give up because your present situation feels confusing. Don't give up because the future scares you to death. Don't give up. No matter where you are, don't give up because it feels impossible. Don't give up because it feels unattainable. Why? Because God is not finished working in your life and working through you. Don't give up. Now listen, this is what some of you came here to hear, this point right here. Somebody is about to get set free. If you don't give up at just the right time, you will reap a harvest of blessing. At just the right time, you will reap a harvest of blessing. Well, why are you saying that, Aaron? Because that's what God's word says. Galatians 6:9. So let's not get tired of what's doing good. Let's not get tired of doing what is good. Let's not get tired. Some of you are exhausted. You've come in this morning with your 4 shots, double frat, macchiato, latte, something or others, and you're like, I'm still exhausted. I can barely stand up. I don't know how much longer I can go forward. But God's word says, let's not get tired of what's doing good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessings if we don't give up. At just the right time, you will reap a harvest. Notice it doesn't say in your timing, doesn't say in my timing. I really wish it would. I really wish we could decide when. But the right time is God's time. Why? I don't know. He made the rules, so he gets to be in charge. But it's his timing. In his timing, you will reap a harvest. There's been confusion about some of these terms, harvest. It does not mean you're going to reap a harvest of corn or hay. Blessings has been confused because it's an overused word in our society. Go on Facebook and you see somebody had a cupcake for dinner and they got prayer hands and blessed. It's a little overused. You got DJ Khaled, who's bless up, blessed to the most high. He became famous for bless up. If you don't know who DJ Khaled is, just ask a teenager. They know who he is. But the harvest of blessing is meaning an outpouring of God's divine favor in our life. If that's you, who wants God's divine favor in your life? Me too. So we have to go after it. We have to live life like Joseph and let God move. And it does say you will reap. It doesn't say you might. This is not a perhaps. I hope so. Well, George, maybe. No, it says you will. It's a guarantee. But there's one qualification to it. Hey, put it back up, Deb. There's one qualification. If we don't give up, all of that will happen if you don't get tired and don't give up. Don't give up. Too many people quit right before breakthrough. The hard things you're going through are not meaningless. It's not pointless. It's not endless. God knows. It's the buildup. God is building you up for breakthrough. All of Joseph's things he went through was a buildup so he could have breakthrough and God can position him. And God didn't punish Joseph. He wasn't being mean to Joseph. He was building him up. He allowed it to happen so he could take a boy in from one region and put him in another region so he could raise him up to be second in charge for Pharaoh so he could redeem his own people. But he had to go through all the pain and all the misery to get to the end. Joseph was faithful with what's right was in front of him. That's point number four. Be faithful with your little. Be faithful with your little. Genesis 36, 9. Potiphar gave complete administrative responsibility over everything he owned. With Joseph there, Potiphar didn't worry about a thing except what to eat. Joseph had charge of everything else. Joseph kept being faithful with his little, what was right in front of him, and he was elevated to the right-hand man of Potiphar. He could have quit long ago, but instead Joseph was faithful for what he had. He said to himself, I'm going to take care of what I can be faithful where God has placed me. I can't fix everything, but I can take care of what's right in front of me. And our focus has to be right in front of me, not all the other things. Joseph was faithful with what was in his hand, not what wasn't in his hands or what was going to be in his hands. He was faithful with what was in his hands at that moment. Joseph made himself indispensable and was elevated. But when you read the situation a little bit further, it got worse. In the next verse or two, Potiphar's wife takes a liking to Joseph, and she keeps giving him the looks and the, hey, how you doing? And finally, one night, these are Bible words, she says, hey, why don't you come sleep with me? And she tempts Joseph multiple times, and finally he says no. And he says no every single time. He could have said, you know what? Screw it. I'm a slave. Nothing good's happened to me. What does faithfulness to God done for me? I might as well have a good time. Come on, we're all human beings. We've had these moments in our life when temptations come, and it's been like, why not? Life can't get much worse. But Joseph doesn't do that. Here's what he says. In verse 9, he says, no one here has more authority than I do. He has held nothing back from me except you because you are his wife. Joseph says, how could I do such a wicked thing? It would be a great sin against God. Here, everyone else around him is being faithless, and Joseph remained faithful. He doesn't let his circumstances dictate his faith. He lets his faith dictate him circumstances. And his reward for this godly thing is he gets thrown in jail. He goes from bad to worse. But in jail, Joseph doesn't give up. He keeps these principles, and he keeps working these principles, and he gets elevated in jail. Some of you right now need a job. You need a better job than the one you have. So in the meantime, be the best employee you can at the job you have right now. Jesus said, those who are faithful with a little will be faithful with much. We all want the much. I know I do. No one goes, God, give me a little. We all say, God, give me more. Give me much. God, if you'd only give me more, I could do more. I could take care of my family better. I could pay some bills. I could do this. I could do that. And he's looking at us maybe and he's saying, can you be a little more faithful what you have so I know I can trust you with more? Think about it when you raise your kids. For me, in my household, my room was to clean. The house was, I had chores. If those things weren't done, bread and water, the basics. I wasn't getting the newest video game system. I wasn't getting electronics. I wasn't getting toys until my dad felt that we were taking care of what a little he'd already given us. He used to beat us over the head all the time with, you better keep that car clean because God will never give you another one. Now, I'm not saying go that extreme, but you've probably done the same thing for your kids. Now, if you're just giving your kids things random, willy-nilly, no matter what they're doing, that is a lot more harm than it is good. They just become entitled, and when they become entitled, you'll come to me and I'll remind you of this message. But we have to recognize that sometimes that's how God is trying to train us. Hey, be faithful We don't like that. We hate that. That's not a good analogy, Aaron. Don't use that. But if we're faithful with our little, he'll give us more. Some of us are saying, if I had more money, all my problems would be fixed. No, they wouldn't be, because you've got budget issues. You're terrible with money. I was. Didn't matter how much I made, I didn't have any left. Well, I had a literal lot. I was terrible with it. You know what you need? You need a budget plan. You need to invest some of your little into something that costs money, and you need to buy like a Dave Ramsey program or one of these smart, godly men who will teach you godly finances so you can start to learn how to have more, so when you have more, you still have more. A lot of people say, well, if I got more, I could do more good with it, God. I'll make a deal. I'll give when you give me more. God, I will do this when you give me more. You know what that's like? That's like saying, when I get skinny, I'm going to go on a diet and start to exercise. But until then, nothing. Now, you all know the principle is exercise and diet gets you the results you want. You're not going to get the results until you do that first. The horse goes in front of the cart. It's not the other way around. So if you want a better marriage, start being the better husband or spouse or wife right now. Even if they don't deserve it, you be better, and they're going to see it. You want to be married someday? Well, you better be the type of person someone wants to marry. That's what they used to tell me. Like, you have this ideal spouse, but that ideal spouse doesn't want what you are. So you'd have to move yourself to that position. It's about what happens in you and not what happens to you, all right? So Joseph's story teaches us that we have to choose to rise up and not give up. When we put these principles into practice, it's about what happens in you and not what happens to you. You don't play the blame game. You can't blame your way to a better life. You have to build up to the breakthrough and be faithful in your little. And I add one more that I want you to make a declaration in your life. If you need to say it 7 times, 3 times, 21 times, or 40 times. Those are godly numbers, so just go with 40. That sounds good. 40 times a day. The last point. I am who God says I am. I am who God says I am. No matter what happened to me, no matter what that person did to me, no matter what trauma and victim, you were victimized, but you're not a victim. I am who God says I am. I am who God says I am. You are deeply loved, highly favored. He loves you more than you can count. You're empowered, you're embraced. You're one of his children. He shaped you, formed you, made you exactly like you are. He gave you a plan long before you had a name. We don't earn it. We accept his love. So I want us to say that phrase a couple times this morning. I am who God says I am. Come on, say it like your life means it matters here. Like your life depends on it. I am who God says I am. I've heard you be louder. Mean it. Come on. I am who God says I am. I am who God says I am. There should be freedom in that this morning. And some of you this morning, as I've talked directly to you. And so we adjusted our plan this morning because we felt God that wants the moment where we are going to change. Some of you are going to walk in a victim, and you're going to walk out with a new identity. And you're going to feel it on the inside. God's ready to move. But here's the thing. You don't move, he can't move. Some of you are on the edge of quitting. And I know who you are. So we're going to offer you a chance this morning. I've got a couple people who are going to come down. We're going to pray for you. And we're going to make this the moment. You're going to come down what you were, and you're going to leave who God made you. Because no matter what you've done, what was done to you, what's going on in your life right now, you are who God says you are. And so I want to give you an opportunity to experience that this morning. I think I got some people in here like, I'm desperate to stop being a victim. I am desperate to stop being what I am. I want to be, but I can't. I don't know how. It's where God's power comes into play. It's where his presence. It's why we draw in his presence, because my words won't change you, but his presence and his power will change you and mold you and shape you and make you different. You will feel it, and it'll continue to elevate and grow in your life. There is healing this morning for those who are willing to grab hold. Some of you have been holding on to what happened with both hands. God says, give me your hands, I got you. It's time for a new step. It's time for a new name. So Stephanie's going to come up front. And we're going to start singing What a Beautiful Name It Is, because it's His name above all names. And if you're here this morning and you want freedom this morning, you want forgiveness, you want to move forward as God sees you and God's made you and God has called you, rush to the front this morning. The door is open. Go through it. There is a window. This is the time. The window will close. Don't miss the window. There's an opportunity this morning. Go ahead, Deb.